His family built Laurel Shopping Center in 1956.
Where do you want me to freeze? This is depressing. Oh my gosh.
It is. It really is.
Part two of our History of Laurel Shopping Center special features an on-site interview with Denny Berman as we look back at the 1964 edition of the Heck Company and the 1966 expansion that connected it to the rest of the shopping center. We'll also cover the 1971 edition of Georgetown Alley. And the shopping center's Day of Infamy, the shooting of Governor George Wallace in 1972. Last but not least, we'll explore the 1979 arrival of Laurel Centre Mall.
I'm Richard Friend, and this is Lost Laurel.
Recently, I had the pleasure of meeting up with historian and Laurel Leader columnist Kevin Leonard and Denny Berman, general partner of Berman Enterprises. Denny's father, Melvin Berman, along with his uncle, Wolford Berman, and their partner, Arthur Robinson, were the men who built Laurel Shopping Center, among numerous other contributions to the city. Despite a chilly December rain, we took a nostalgic walk around this familiar but ever-changing property.
So what was the secret behind the shopping center's success right away? Because right away it was a big success.
Well, the secret behind it, that was in the days when there were very few shopping centers in the country at all. The idea of putting stores in one place with the parking all part of it was still relatively very new. This shopping center, it's hard to believe, between Baltimore and Washington, preceded ones like Tyson's Corner, Landover, Wheaton Plaza, the ones that we think were very old ones that were the beginning of success. This one was really one of, if not the first one in the Washington area, certainly one of them. But what also made for so much success were my father and uncle. They ran a merchants association that was second to none. I mean, they met with the tenants all the time. They were always around here. The tenants liked them. I remember years later when I was old enough to be working and I would walk prospects around and they couldn't believe it. The tenants would come out and talk to me and like me. You know, you would say, what's wrong with this? People here like their landlord. But the Merchants Association was very active. The original center was large enough to have a Merchants Association, but small enough that everybody felt that their contribution made a difference and it was somewhat like a family. And because of that, they all actually did pull together, and I remember that as a child. So it was a combination of being in the right place at the right time and really operating it really well.
And how did they come up with the idea for the mix between the chains and the moms and pops? How did that all come about?
That's a good question. As a six-year-old, I wasn't privy to that. But knowing the way my father was, because I worked with him for many years after that, He would look at it and say, you need the chains to make the presence of the place. So something like the Giant and the People's Drug, I'm sure, was a necessary condition for having a shopping center that he was looking at. To have both Kresge's and Woolworth's, that was unheard of. I believe we were the only place in the country that had that. And that was my father's persistence. He played one against the other, and he told me, he said, unbelievably, I got both. And so he was very happy to have both because their money was good. They would always pay. But the real money was made from the smaller ones. The rents for the larger ones, you had to give them much better deals. So you didn't want to rent the whole shopping center to the large chains because if you did, there wouldn't be any cash flow left over. So there is an art and a science to real estate, and this is part of it.
Why did they choose Laurel? This was such a new concept. Why here?
That is a great question. I asked my father that many times over the years. I got answers, and excuse me, but none of them made any sense. Because there's only one that made sense, and I'll get to it in a second. Back then, like I say, there was no Wheaton Plaza, no Tyson's Corner, no Landover. There were loads of places that had far more population than Laurel. Laurel was a small city surrounded by nothing but land and farms. So you'd think if you're going to build a shopping center, you would start in the populated areas closer to Washington, D.C. But they didn't. They started here. The only thing that made sense is we lived in Skaggsville a few miles away. They knew Laurel, and that's why it's here.
Now, you had said something to me once that when they opened the Section 2, that it affected that relationship that you just talked about between the tenants and your dad. Something changed, you were talking about.
It's not that the old tenants' relationship with my father and uncle got worse. It was that now the shopping center was presto, twice as big. There were twice as many tenants. There were a lot of new tenants that didn't have the history of the 10 years of Laurel building up, because during that 10 years there was a lot of development in Laurel, of the growth of the area. The Merchants Association had a whole lot of new people. It's kind of like if somebody's a member of a church or a synagogue and it starts off with 20 members, every member feels like my contribution is important. So you get all 20 members show up to work on it. When the place grows like everybody wants it to, and now you have 250 members, you might only get 10 volunteers instead of 20 because nobody feels like their effort means that much. The same thing happened then for the Merchants Association. It still existed. It still was, by people's account, the best Merchants Association around, but it wasn't anywhere near what it was in the 1956 to 1966 period.
Now, I know you were a child. Do you remember the excitement around the 15 Fabulous Days?
I remember that well, actually.
Do you remember, being in the fashion show?
No, but I remember being in the helicopter. The helicopter came out to our place in Skaggsville, picked my brother and me up, and brought us here. And that was, there's no way I'm forgetting that. I do remember the excitement of the different things going on, the sports teams. I was much more interested in sports teams than a fashion show. I think I was even in the fashion show, but that's not something that for a six-year-old boy is really terribly memorable.
Well, where we're standing was Georgetown Alley, which was, you said, Section 3, right?
This is Section 3.
So what was, Georgetown Alley had a very specific appeal to it. It was supposed to go after the young shopper and all that. I remember the one ad that said, Woodstock comes to Laurel. So what was the idea behind Georgetown Alley?
Well, Georgetown Alley was the completion of the shopping center. This was the end of the land. There was still other land, but it was for office buildings, which eventually got built. And the idea was this was going to be a two-story section with a parking garage in the back, which that parking garage has long ago been torn down. And it was going to be another type of anchor to the center. Over there was the Heck Company, which now is different stores, but that was also an anchor to the center. And it would have stores facing in this mall area that would then people would be going to the Heck Company. And you'd have these small shops in the Georgetown Alley section. And I would say it partially worked. The idea that it would be little boutiques and things like that for the younger shopper, and that's not really what it became. I mean, probably the best known tenant in this area was the Laurel Health Food Store. And there was a gift shop and a couple other little shops, but it did fine, but didn't take off as its own area like it was originally supposed to.
There was a story behind how Montgomery Ward came to be. You told me that. Do you remember that?
I remember that. I was about 16 or 17 when the story occurred. The store got built when I was 18 in 1968. My father one day takes the newspaper, opens it up. He always read the people, go out and have coffee, a donut, and a newspaper. And he looks and he sees Montgomery Ward coming to Laurel. He says, how in the world did they coming to Laurel? And I don't know about it. And then they have a map of where they're coming. I said, well, that's interesting. They're coming to my land. That's always good to know. So he called them up. And he said it wasn't very easy to get a hold of somebody. And finally got a hold of somebody. And he tells the person who was in the real estate office, we need to talk. Yeah, why do I need to talk to you? Well, you're coming to Laurel. So, well, you're coming to my land. You still haven't talked to me, so I think it's a good idea that we talk. And they talked and they made a deal, and Montgomery Ward did come to Laurel.
So why was it so far from the existing shopping center?
The existing shopping center was built in a way that it didn't lend itself to putting a department store next to it, unless you tore down a big part of it, which would have made no sense whatsoever back then. My father and uncle owned 24 acres adjacent, which they bought after, it used to be the old sanitarium, And they bought that after the shopping center was had been built for a number of years. And they always intended more development on that 24 acres. They weren't clear what it was going to be. When Montgomery Ward's wanted to come, they wanted to come to the corner of Cherry Lane and Route 1. So that fit one of the visions that my father and uncle had to build a mall there. I said, okay, if they want to come, that's fine. We'll let them come first. We'll design it in a way that that will be the anchor when the eventual mall gets built. And that's what happened. It took 11 years for that mall to eventually get built. But Montgomery Ward's was set up that was supposed to happen, and it eventually did.
Now, your father had a relationship with James Rouse, didn't he?
He had quite a relationship with James Rouse. My father was one of the, most people would consider him one of the original board members. He actually joined the board about 2 months after what was then Community Research and Development, which later became the Rouse Company, after that was formed. So my father was very involved in all the shopping center development that the Rouse Company did over the years. And he was even more involved in Columbia. He was the original idea behind Columbia, because really we lived there. And he knew James Rouse well, and they were friends and business partners.
Tell me, what was it like with all, when you first got involved with the company, what was it like dealing with both the city of Laurel and PG County?
Well, I first came to work after college and grad school in 1973. I just turned 23 years old. So I actually knew a number of the people in the city just because having been around here all those years, they knew me as a kid and growing up. The relationships with the city were great. We had good relationships. The city was the government of the city, which the city can still easily be dealt with. It's not like a big government. Back then it was even smaller. I mean, if you wanted to talk about something, you'd go over there and you'd find the mayor or whoever you needed to speak to, and it was very, very easy. Today it's a little more difficult, not because anybody's difficult, just bigger. The county, on the other hand, I always found an enigma. It was very difficult to do things. Permits took, from my point of view, forever. Of course, there's a certain humor to that. When we were building 312 Marshall, the 10-story building that's adjacent to the shopping center, it took a whole month to get a permit. Now today it would take over a year. My father gave my cousin and I just constant grief. How can you take so long? What's wrong with you guys? I used to just walk in and get the permits. Well, it had changed, and there were all sorts of more rules, and there's continuously more rules, and it just takes a long time. In the county, we always found difficulty dealing with, which I just want to say today, in 2014, thank God it's a lot better. I give this administration a lot of credit.
When you said that you, as a kid, you used to kind of pitch in and do things. What kind of work did you do around here as a kid?
Sometimes pick up trash and things like that. I mean, when I say pitched in, I mean, as a little kid, it would always be of the trash related variety. In 1966, when Section 2, the area over here, was being built, my cousin, brother, and I all worked construction for part of that summer. And of course there, the people who were the head of the construction decided that they wanted to have fun with the owner's sons. So they would say, well, carry that pile of drywall from here over here. And then when we're done, well, no, we need it back here again. And we ended up sweeping the same places numerous times, carrying the drywall, and it was pretty awful.
What you learned?
I didn't learn much then. I have to tell you, what I really learned was that I could have done it much better than the people who were running it when I was 16. And back then, that might have been arrogant, but later I built many buildings, and that was true. I could have done it better than they did.
Well, once you came on board, were you personally involved in any promotions with all the new sections opening up?
My cousin and I worked around the shopping center for about 3 years before we went on our own. So yes, we were involved in the promotions, and they were similar type of promotions over the years, whether it's old fashioned days or a car show or different contests, always corny, right through. For my father and uncle, corny was good, and it was good. We used to get nice crowds for that.
Okay. All right, well, Denny, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
The 52-year-old Wallace had just finished talking to a crowd at a shopping center in Laurel, Maryland, and had stepped from behind a bullet.
Less than a year after the completion of Georgetown Alley in 1971, a controversial presidential candidate would make a campaign appearance at Laurel Shopping Center. The date was May 15, 1972. Today's landmarks, the Wallace shooting took place near the center of the parking lot between what is now the American National Bank and Harbor Freight Tools. Originally the State Bank of Laurel, the building actually began as a single-family house, which the bank was literally built around. At the time of the Wallace shooting, however, it was an Equitable Trust Bank. The Harbor Freight Tools location was, of course, Woolworth's. In this photo taken just 1 month later, bank employee Barry Bragg stands at the spot where Wallace was shot. He points toward the area where the stage had been assembled from which Wallace spoke, the same stage that had been used in the 1956 grand opening and would be used for countless promotions over at least the next decade. Approximately 1,000 spectators had come to Laurel Shopping Center to either hear or jeer George Wallace's campaign speech, and most dispersed in the aftermath as he was whisked away to Holy Cross Hospital. Wallace would survive the shooting in spite of a total of 5 wounds, including shots to the chest and abdomen, but he'd be confined to a wheelchair and in constant pain for the remaining 26 years of his life. He died in 1998, having spent years renouncing his segregationist past, apologizing, and attempting to rectify the general perception of him as an unvarnished racist, a view he claimed brought him more pain than the shooting itself. His would-be assassin, Arthur Bremer, was a 21-year-old from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, with no ties to Laurel whatsoever. His diary, published after his arrest, revealed that the assassination attempt was motivated by a desire for fame rather than politics, and that President Richard Nixon had also been an earlier target. Bremer's actions inspired the screenplay for the 1976 film Taxi Driver, which in turn provoked the 1981 assassination attempt of President Ronald Reagan by John Hinckley Jr. Bremer would spend the next 35 years in a Hagerstown, Maryland prison before being released 18 years early in 2007. Now living in Cumberland, he remains on supervised release until 2025. One Laurel couple had a particularly harrowing story to tell after the shooting. Mabel and Ross Spiegel were standing directly in front of Bremer when he literally reached between them and fired. Ross was the gentleman in the baseball cap, whose tattooed arm can be seen grabbing for Bremer's pistol. He was the first to wrestle the attacker to the ground, acting out of instinct and likely preventing any further injuries. But the Spiegel story didn't end there. Mabel proved to be a dynamic witness at the trial. After 3 of the first prosecution witnesses failed to identify Bremer as the shooter, she walked among trial spectators where the defendant had been placed for identification purposes, reached out, and touched him. Most thought they'd seen Laurel Shopping Center's expansion completed in 1966, only to be treated to Georgetown Alley just 5 years later. By 1978, plans were well underway to make use of the land behind Section 1, between the shopping center and the standalone Montgomery Ward's building near Cherry Lane. But the land wasn't completely vacant. For a few precious years, Playmore Miniature Golf and a go-kart track were popular attractions. Both opened in 1972, but were forced to close when construction began on the new Laurel Centre Mall. While the Bermans had always envisioned it, the actual development of Laurel Centre Mall was done by the Shopco Company, at that time the nation's fifth largest developer of shopping centers. The Bermans leased the property to Shopco, who both built and stocked the mall with tenants. Montgomery Ward, which had opened in 1969, had it in their lease that they would eventually adjoin Laurel Shopping Center by way of a connecting mall. It took nearly 10 years, but with the arrival of Laurel Center, that's exactly what happened. Ward's would be the first of three anchor stores, including Hex and JCPenney. While the Ward's building went largely unchanged from the outside, its north interior wall had to be modified for entrance to the new mall. Architects compensated for the difference in its single-story elevation, which is why Ward's entrance was the only one to be located on a mezzanine level. Direct connection to the outdoor shopping center would come by way of JCPenney, which would feature an elevated walkway. Accessible from an entrance beside Woolworth's that was originally Miles' Shoe Store, the connector would link visitors to the upper level of Penney's, entering into the TV department. The mall's centerpiece was its center court, which included a recessed stage surrounded by multi-level bench seating. The venue hosted countless programs, including concerts and other performances. Even the Maryland Lottery held a live televised drawing in January 1980. WMAR-TV2's Stu Kerr drew the lucky number 804. Directly below the center court was an even more impressive feature, the carousel shops. A total of seven small boutique stores occupied the carousel, which actually did rotate at the almost imperceptible speed of one full turn per hour. These being the days before cordless phones and Wi-Fi, C&P telephone engineers had to design a special phone system to fit the needs of the revolving stores, without the wires becoming hopelessly entangled. Construction and preparations continued on the mall all the way up to opening day and beyond. Knowing that at most it would only be 80% complete, opening day was set for October 11, 1979. The Heck Company would be a late arrival, becoming the mall's third anchor store in May 1981. Hex had the interesting task of relocating from its original 1964 building in the outdoor shopping center and looked forward to a brand new two-story facility. The old building, nearly unrecognizable today as a completely renovated LA Fitness, would see a number of tenants over the next three decades, including Woolco, Jamesway, Lionel Kitty City, and Toys R Us. Two memorable features of the new Hex were the Land of Oz, a toy section in the lower level, and upstairs, Edgar's Restaurant. The official grand opening of Laurel Center borrowed a page from the historic 15 Fabulous Days promotion that had opened Laurel Shopping Center back in 1956. Beginning at 11:30 a.m. on Thursday, October 11, 1979, the mall opened with a complete schedule of hourly festivities until 8 p.m. that night. This was just the first of 11 total days extending to October 21st, each with a distinctive theme, Italian Day, Polish Day, Hispanic Day, etc., offering a literal taste of ethnic foods, music, and entertainment. Of course, there were contests too, and plenty of them, including a new Honda from Auto House Tischer, a $500 shopping spree from the Merchants Association, and my personal dream prize, a pinball machine from Time Out. Every grand opening celebration requires a ribbon cutting, and Laurel Center's was one for the ages. Mayor Robert DiPietro did the honors, cutting a 6,000-foot ribbon that literally wrapped the entire mall, extending from Montgomery Ward all the way to JCPenney. The grand opening was a huge success, and crowds flocked to check out the new stores and every little detail of the new mall. While most were preoccupied with the shiny new mall, the older stores of the outside shopping center also received a makeover. The subdued brown canopy with white lettering wasn't the most popular look with critics, but it did help give the older stores a more cohesive appearance in connection with the new Laurel Center. Through the years, through the decades, the shopping center has adapted while sticking true to its roots. The innovative promotions first introduced by the Bermans in 1956 continued throughout the 80s, with countless parades, holiday festivities and decorations, car shows, contests, and other attractions designed to bring people together and entice them to shop. Change in Laurel has always been a constant, and unfortunately, the mall was one casualty that did not age well. Having gone through multiple owners after the Bermans, its decline was only expedited by the latest recession. In 2012, it was demolished. And in 2014, the new town center at Laurel opened in its former location. Laurel Shopping Center now finds itself directly competing with its new next-door neighbor. And just as it always has, it continues to adapt and persevere. If you missed your chance to experience the Laurel Museum's 2014 exhibit, Lost and Found Laurel, in person, you're in for a treat. Join me for a personalized tour as we'll take a closer look at each section and just about every artifact, including the ones you may not have noticed. I'll show you what went into the exhibit and we'll explore the places they came from. Laurel Historical Society Executive Director Lindsay Baker will explain the broader context of the show, and we'll revisit what turned out to be the museum's busiest opening day of all time, an event Laurel Leader columnist Jeff Dudley described as less like an exhibit opening and more like a family reunion. It's all on the next episode of Lost Laurel on Laurel TV.